Rose, the Our Father, Part 1. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. And let us ask Our Lady to shower her graces down upon us of wisdom and understanding, so that we may fully comprehend and put into practice the teachings from St. Louis de Montfort. And we pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. St. Louis de Montfort, pray for us. The Our Father, or the Lord's Prayer, has great value, above all because of its author, who is neither a man nor an angel, but the King of angels and men, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. St. Cyprian says that it was fitting that our Savior, by whom we were reborn into the life of grace, should also be our Heavenly Master and should teach us how to pray. The beautiful order, the tender forcefulness, and the clarity of this divine prayer pay tribute to our Divine Master's wisdom. It is a short prayer, but can teach us so very much, and it is well within the grasp of uneducated people, while scholars find it a continual source of meditation on the mysteries of our faith. The Our Father contains all the duties we owe to God, the acts of all the virtues, and the petitions for all our spiritual and corporal needs. Tertullian says that the Our Father is a summary of the New Testament. Thomas a Kempis says that it surpasses all the desires of all the saints, that it is a condensation of all the beautiful sayings of all the Psalms and Canticles, that in it we ask God for everything that we need, that by it we praise Him in the very best way, that by it we lift up our souls from earth to heaven and unite them with God. St. John Chrysostom says that we cannot be our Master's disciples unless we pray as He did and in the way that He showed us. Moreover, God the Father listens more willingly to the prayer that we have learned from His Son rather than those of our own making, which have all our human limitations. We should say the Our Father with the certitude that the Eternal Father will hear it, because it is the prayer of His Son whom He always hears, and we are His members. God will surely grant our petitions made through the Lord's Prayer, because it is impossible to imagine that such a good Father could refuse a request couched in the language of so worthy a Son, reinforced by His merits, and made at His behest. St. Augustine says that whenever we say the Our Father devoutly, our venial sins are forgiven. The just man falls 7 times a day, but in the Lord's Prayer, he will find 7 petitions, which will both help him to avoid downfalls and will protect him from his spiritual enemies. Our Lord, knowing how weak and helpless we are, and how many difficulties we get into, made His prayer short and easy to say, so that if we say it devoutly and often, we can be sure that Almighty God will quickly come to our aid. I have a word for you, devout souls, who pay little attention to the prayer that the Son of God gave us Himself, and asked us all to say. It is high time for you to change your way of thinking. You only like prayers that men have written, as though anybody, even the most inspired man in the whole world, could possibly know more about how he ought to pray than Jesus Christ Himself. You look for prayers in books written by other men, almost as though you were ashamed of saying the prayer that our Lord told us to say. You have managed to convince yourself that the prayers in these books are for scholars and for rich people of the upper classes, and that the Rosary is only for women and children and the lower classes. As if the prayers and praises which you have been reading were more beautiful and more pleasing to God than those which are to be found in the Lord's Prayer. It is a dangerous temptation to lose interest in the prayer that our Lord gave us and to take up prayers that men have written instead. Not that I disapprove of prayers that the saints have written so as to encourage the faithful to praise God. But it is not to be endured that they should prefer the latter to the prayer which was uttered by wisdom incarnate. If they ignore this prayer, it is just as though they pass up the spring to go after the brook, and refusing the clear water, drink dirty water instead. Because the rosary made up of the Lord's Prayer and the angelic salutation is this clever and ever-flowing water which comes from the fountain of grace, whereas other prayers, which they look for in books, are nothing but tiny streams which spring from this fountain. People who say our Lord's Prayer carefully, weighing every word and meditating upon it, may indeed call themselves blessed, for they find therein everything that they need or can wish for. When we say this wonderful prayer, we touch God's heart at the very outset by calling him by the sweet name of Father, our Father. He is the dearest of fathers, all-powerful in his creation, wonderful in the way he maintains the world, completely lovable in his divine providence, always good and infinitely so in the redemption. We have God for our Father, so we are all brothers, and in heaven as our homeland and our heritage. This should be more than enough to teach us to love God and our neighbor and to be detached from the things of this world. So we ought to love our Heavenly Father and should say to him over and over again, Our Father, who art in heaven, thou who dost fill heaven and earth with the immensity of thy being, thou who art present everywhere, thou who art in the saints by thy glory, in the damned by thy justice, in the good by thy grace, and even in sinners by thy patience, with which thou dost tolerate them. Grant, we beseech thee, that we may always remember that we come from thee. Grant that we may live as thy true children ought to live. Grant that we may set our course towards thee and never swerve. Grant that we may use our every power, our hearts and souls and strength, to tend towards thee and thee alone. Hallowed be thy name. King David the prophet said that the name of the Lord is holy and awe-inspiring, and Isaiah that heaven is always echoing with the praises of the seraphim who unceasingly praise the holiness of the Lord God of hosts. We ask here that all the world may learn to know and adore the attributes of our God, who is so great and so holy. We ask that he may be known, loved, and adored by pagans, Turks, Jews, barbarians, and by all infidels, that all men may serve and glorify him by a living faith, a staunch hope, a burning charity, and by renouncing all erroneous beliefs. This all adds up to say that we pray that all men may be holy, because our God himself is all holy. Thy kingdom come. Do thou reign in our souls by thy grace, so that after death we may be found meet to reign with thee in thy kingdom, in perfect and unending bliss. O Lord, we firmly believe in this happiness to come. We hope for and we expect it, because God the Father has promised it in his great goodness. It was purchased for us by the merits of God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, he who is the light, has made it known to us. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. As Tertullian says, this sentence does not in the least mean that we are afraid of people thwarting God's designs, because nothing whatsoever can happen without divine providence having foreseen it and having made it fit into his plans beforehand. No obstruction in the whole world can possibly prevent the will of God from being carried out. Rather, when we say thy will be done, we ask God to make us humbly resigned to all that he has seen fit to send us in his life. We also ask him to help us to do in all things and at all times his holy will, made known to us by the commandments, promptly, lovingly, and faithfully, as the saints and angels do it in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Our Lord taught us to ask God for everything that we need, whether in the spiritual or temporal order. By asking for our daily bread, we humbly admit our own poverty and insufficiency and pay tribute to our God, knowing that all temporal goods come from His divine providence. When we say bread, we ask for that which is just necessary to live. And of course, this does not include luxuries. We ask for this bread today, this day, which means that we are concerned only for the present, leaving the morrow in the hands of Providence. And when we ask for our daily bread, we recognize that we need God's help every day, and that we are entirely dependent upon Him for His help and protection. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Every sin, says St. Augustine and Tertullian, is a debt which we contract towards Almighty God, and His justice demands payment down to the very last farthing. Unfortunately, we all have these sad debts. No matter how many they may be, we should go to God in all confidence and with true sorrow for our sins, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, forgive us our sins of thought and those of speech. Forgive us our sins of commission and omission, which make us infinitely guilty in the eyes of thy divine justice. We dare to ask this because thou art our loving and merciful Father, and because we have forgotten those who have offended us out of obedience to thee and out of charity. Do not permit us, in spite of our infidelity to thy graces, to give in to the temptations of the world, the devil, and the flesh. But deliver us from evil. The evil of sin, and also of temporal punishment and everlasting punishment, which we know that we have rightly deserved. Amen. So be it. This word at the end of the Our Father is very consoling, and Saint Jerome says that it is a sort of seal of approbation that Almighty God puts at the end of our petitions to assure us that He will grant our requests, very much as though He Himself were answering. Amen. May it be as you have asked, for verily you have obtained what you have asked for. This is what is meant by the word Amen. 13th Rose, the Our Father, Part 2. Each word of the Lord's Prayer is a tribute we pay to the perfections of God. We honor His fertility by the name of Father. Father, Thou who throughout eternity dost beget a Son, who is God like Thee, eternal, consubstantial with Thee, who is the very same essence as Thee, and is of like power and goodness and wisdom as Thou art. Father and Son, who from Thy mutual love produce the Holy Spirit, who is God like unto Thee, three persons, but one God. Our Father. This means that He is the Father of mankind because He has created us and continues to sustain us, and because He has redeemed us. He is also the merciful Father of sinners, the Father who is the friend of the just and the glorious Father of the blessed in heaven. When we say, Who art, by these words we pay tribute to the infinity and immensity and fullness of God's essence. God is rightly called He who is. That is to say, He exists of necessity, essentially and eternally, because He is the being of beings and the cause of all beings. He possesses within Himself, in a supereminent degree, the perfections of all beings, and He is in all of them by His essence, by His presence, and by His power, but without being bounded by their limitations. We honor His sublimity and His glory and His majesty by the words, Who art in heaven? That is to say, who is seated as on a throne, holding sway over all men by thy justice. When we say, Hallowed be thy name, we worship God's holiness and we make obeisance to His kingship and bow to the justice of His laws by the words, Thy kingdom come, praying that men will obey Him on earth as the angels do in heaven. We show our trust in his providence by asking for our daily bread, and we appeal to his mercy when we ask for the forgiveness of our sins. We look to his great power when we beg him not to lead us into temptation, and we show our faith in his goodness by our hope that he will deliver us from evil. The Son of God has always glorified his Father by his works, and he came into the world to teach men to give glory to him. He showed men how to praise him by this prayer, which he taught us with his own lips. It is our duty, therefore, to say it often. We should say it reverently and attentively, and in the spirit in which our Lord taught it. 14th Rose, the Our Father, Part 3. We make as many acts of the noblest Christian virtues as we pronounce words when we recite attentively this divine prayer. In saying, Our Father who art in heaven, we make acts of faith, adoration, and humility. When we ask that his name be hallowed and glorified, we show a burning zeal for his glory. And when we ask for the spread of his kingdom, we make an act of hope by the wish that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We show a spirit of perfect obedience. In asking for our daily bread, we practice poverty of spirit and detachment from worldly goods. When we beg him to forgive us our sins, we make an act of sorrow for them. By forgiving those who have trespassed against us, we give proof of the virtue of mercy in its highest degree. Through asking God's help in all our temptations, we make acts of humility, prudence, and fortitude. As we wait for him to deliver us from evil, we exercise the virtue of patience. Finally, while asking for all these things, not for ourselves alone, but also for our neighbor and for all members of the church, we are carrying out our duty as true children of God. We are imitating him in his love, which embraces all men, and we are keeping the commandment of love of neighbor. If we mean in our hearts what we say with our lips, and if our intentions are not at variance with those expressed in the Lord's Prayer, then by reciting this prayer, we hate all sin, and we observe all of God's laws. For whenever we think that God is in heaven, infinitely removed from us by the greatness of his majesty, as we place ourselves in his presence, we should be filled with overwhelming reverence. Then the fear of the Lord will chase away all pride, and we will bow down before God in our utter nothingness. When we say the name Father, and remember that we owe our existence to God by the means of our parents, and even our knowledge to our teachers who hold the place and are the living images of God, then we cannot help paying them honor and respect, or, to be more exact, honoring God in them. Nothing then, too, would be farther from our thoughts than to be disrespectful to them or hurt them. We are never farther from blaspheming than when we pray that the holy name of God may be glorified. If we really look upon the kingdom of God as our heritage, we cannot possibly be attached to the things of this world. If we sincerely ask God that our neighbors may have the very same blessings that we ourselves stand in need of, it goes without saying that we will give up all hatred, quarreling, and jealousy. And of course, if we ask God each day for our daily bread, we shall learn to hate gluttony and lasciviousness, which thrive in rich surroundings. While sincerely asking God to forgive us as we forgive those who trespass against us, we no longer give way to anger and thoughts of getting even. We return good for evil and really love our enemies. To ask God to save us from falling into sin when we are tempted is to give proof that we are fighting laziness and that we are genuinely seeking means to root out vicious habits and to work at our salvation. To pray God to deliver us from evil is to fear his justice, and this will give us true happiness. For since the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, it is through the virtue of the fear of God that men avoid sin. 15th Rose, the Hail Mary. The angelic salutation is so heavenly and so beyond us in its depth of meaning that Blessed Alain de la Roche held that no mere cute creature could ever possibly understand it, and that only our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who was born of the Blessed Virgin Mary, can really explain it. Its enormous value is due first of all to Our Lady, to whom it was addressed, to the purpose of the incarnation of the Word, for which reason this prayer was brought from heaven, and also to the Archangel Gabriel, who was the first ever to say it. The angelic salutation is the most concise summary of all that Catholic theology teaches about the Blessed Virgin. It is divided into two parts, that of praise and petition. The first shows all that goes to make up Mary's greatness, and the second all that we need to ask her for and all that we may expect to receive through her goodness. The Most Blessed Trinity revealed the first part of it to us, and the latter part was added by Saint Elizabeth, who was inspired by the Holy Spirit. Holy Mother Church gave us the conclusion in the year 430, when she condemned the Nestorian heresy at the Council of Ephesus, and defined that the Blessed Virgin is truly the Mother of God. At this time, she ordered us to pray to Our Lady under this glorious title by saying, Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. The greatest event in the whole of history of the world was the incarnation of the Eternal Word, by whom the world was redeemed and peace was restored between God and men. Our Lady was chosen as his instrument for this tremendous event, and it was put into effect when she was greeted with the angelic salutation. The Archangel Gabriel, one of the leading princes of the heavenly court, was chosen as ambassador to bear these glad tidings. In the angelic salutation can be seen the faith and hope of the patriarchs, the prophets, and the apostles. Furthermore, it gives to martyrs their unswerving constancy and strength. It is the wisdom of the doctors of the church, the perseverance of holy confessors, and the life of all religious. Blessed Alain de la Roche, it is also the new hymn of the law of grace, the joy of angels and men, and the hymn which terrifies devils and puts them to shame. By the angelic salutation, God became man. A virgin became the mother of God. The souls of the just were delivered from limbo. The empty thrones in heaven filled. In addition, sin was forgiven. Grace was given to us. Sick people were made well. The dead were brought back to life. Exiles were brought home. And the anger of the Most Blessed Trinity was appeased, and men obtained eternal life. Finally, the angelic salutation is a rainbow in the heavens, a sign of the mercy and grace which God has given to the world. 16th Rose, the Hail Mary, Beauty. Even though there is nothing so great as the majesty of God, and nothing so low as man insofar as he is a sinner, Almighty God does not despise our poor prayers. On the contrary, he is pleased when we sing his praises. Saint Gabriel's greeting to Our Lady is one of the most beautiful hymns which we can possibly sing to the glory of the Most High. I will sing a new song to you. This new hymn, which David foretold, was to be sung at the coming of the Messiah in none other than the angelic salutation. There is an old hymn and a new hymn. The first is that which the Jews sang out of gratitude to God for creating them and maintaining them in existence, for delivering them from captivity and leading them safely through the Red Sea, for giving them manna to eat, and for all his other blessings. The new hymn is that which Christians sing in thanksgiving for the graces of the Incarnation and the Redemption. As these marvels were brought about by the angelic salutation, so also do we repeat the same salutation to thank the Most Blessed Trinity for his immeasurable goodness to us. We praise God the Father because he so loved the world that he gave us his only Son as our Savior. We bless the Son because he deigned to leave heaven and came down upon earth, because he was made man and redeemed us. We glorify the Holy Spirit because he formed our Lord's pure body in Our Lady's womb. This body, which was the victim of our sins. In this spirit of deep thankfulness, should we then always say the Hail Mary, making acts of faith, hope, love, and thanksgiving for the priceless gift of salvation? Although this new hymn is in praise of the Mother of God and is sung directly to her, nevertheless, it greatly glorifies the Most Blessed Trinity, because any homage that we pay Our Lady returns inevitably to God, who is the cause of all her virtues and perfections. When we honor Our Lady, God the Father is glorified, because we are honoring the most perfect of His creatures. God the Son is glorified, because we are praising His most pure Mother. And God the Holy Spirit is glorified, because we are lost in admiration at the graces with which He has filled His spouse. When we praise and bless Our Lady by saying the angelic salutation, she always passes on these praises to Almighty God in the same way as she did when she was praised by Saint Elizabeth. The latter blessed her in her most elevated dignity as Mother of God, and Our Lady immediately returned these praises to God by her beautiful Magnificat. Just as the angelic salutation gives glory to the Blessed Trinity, it is also the very highest praise that we can give Our Lady. One day, when Saint Mechtilda was praying and was trying to think of some way in which she could express her love of the Blessed Mother better than she had done before, she fell into ecstasy. Our Lady appeared to her with the angelic salutation in flaming letters of gold upon her bosom and said to her, "My daughter, I want you to know that no one can please me more than by saying the salutation which the most adorable Trinity sent to me, and by which He raised me to the dignity of Mother of God. By the word Ave, which is the name Eve, Eva, I learned that in His infinite power God had preserved me from all sin and its attendant misery, which the first woman had been subjected to." The name Mary, which means Lady of Light, shows that God has filled me with wisdom and light, like a shining star, to light up heaven and earth. The words full of grace remind me that the Holy Spirit has showered so many graces upon me that I am able to give these graces in abundance to those who ask for them through me as mediatrix. When people say the Lord is with thee, they renew the indescribable joy that was mine when the eternal Word became incarnate in my womb. When you say to me, "Blessed art thou among women," I praise Almighty God's divine mercy, which lifted me to this exalted plane of happiness. And at the words, "Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus," the whole of heaven rejoices with me to see my Son, Jesus Christ, adored and glorified for having saved mankind. 17th Rose. The Hail Mary. Fruits. Blessed Alain de la Roche, who was so deeply devoted to the Blessed Virgin, had many revelations from her, and we know that he confirmed the truth of these revelations by a solemn oath. Three of them stand out with special emphasis. The first, that if people fail to say the Hail Mary, the angelic salutation which has saved the world, out of carelessness, or because they are lukewarm, or because they hate it, this is a sign that they will probably and indeed shortly be condemned to eternal punishment. The second truth is that those who love this divine salutation bear the very special stamp of predestination. The third is that those to whom God has given the signal grace of loving Our Lady and of serving her out of love must take very great care to continue to love and serve her until the time when she shall have had them placed in heaven by her divine Son in the degree of glory which they have earned. The heretics, all of whom are children of the devil and clearly bear the sign of God's reprobation, have a horror of the Hail Mary. They still say the Our Father, but never the Hail Mary. They would rather wear a poisonous snake around their necks than wear a scapular or carry a rosary. Among Catholics, those who bear the mark of God's reprobation think but little of the rosary, whether that of 5 decades or 15. They either fail to say it or only say it very quickly and in a lukewarm manner. Even if I did not believe that which has been revealed to Blessed Alain de la Roche, even then, my own experience would be enough to convince me of this terrible but consoling truth. I do not know, nor do I see clearly, how it can be that a devotion which seems to be so small can be the infallible sign of eternal salvation, and how its absence can be the sign of God's eternal displeasure. Nevertheless, nothing could possibly be more true. In our own day, we see that people who hold new doctrines that have been condemned by Holy Mother Church may have quite a bit of service piety, but they scorn the Rosary and often dissuade their acquaintances from saying it by destroying their love of it and their faith in it. In doing this, they make elaborate excuses which are plausible in the eyes of the world. They are very careful not to condemn the Rosary and the Scapular as the Calvinists do, but the way they set about attacking them is all the more deadly because it is the more cunning. I shall refer to it again later on. My Hail Mary, my Rosary of 15 or of 5 decades, is the prayer and the infallible touchstone by which I can tell those who are led by the Spirit of God from those who are deceived by the devil. I have known souls who seem to soar like eagles to the heights by their sublime contemplation, and who yet were pitifully led astray by the devil. I only found out how wrong they were when I learned that they scorned the Hail Mary and the Rosary, which they considered as being far beneath them. The Hail Mary is a blessed dew that falls from heaven upon the souls of the predestinate. It gives them a marvelous spiritual fertility, so that they can grow in all virtues. The more the garden of the soul is watered by this prayer, the more enlightened one's intellect becomes, the more zealous his heart, and the stronger his armor against his spiritual enemies. The Hail Mary is a sharp and flaming shaft, which, joined to the Word of God, gives the preacher the strength to pierce, move, and convert the most hardened hearts, even if he has little or no natural gift for preaching. As I have already said, this was the great secret that Our Lady taught St. Dominic and Blessed Alain, so that they might convert heretics and sinners. St. Antoninus tells us that this is why many priests got into the habit of saying a Hail Mary at the beginning of their sermons. 18th Rose, the Hail Mary, blessings. This heavenly salutation draws down upon us the blessings of Jesus and Mary in abundance. For it is an infallible truth that Jesus and Mary reward in a marvelous way those who glorify them. They repay us 100-fold for the praises that we give them. I love them that love me, that I may enrich them that love me and fill their treasures. Jesus and Mary have always said, "We love those who love us. We enrich them and fill their treasuries to overflowing. He who soweth in blessings shall also reap blessings." Now, if we say the Hail Mary properly, is not this a way to love, bless, and glorify Jesus and Mary? In each Hail Mary, we bless both Jesus and Mary. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. By each Hail Mary, we give Our Lady the same honor that God gave her when he sent the Archangel Gabriel to greet her for him. How could anyone possibly think that Jesus and Mary, who often do good to those that curse them, could ever curse those that bless and honor them by the Hail Mary? Both Saint Bernard and Saint Bonaventure say that the Queen of Heaven is certainly no less grateful and conscientious than gracious and well-mannered people of this world. Just as she excels in all other perfections, she surpasses us in all virtue of gratitude. So she would never let us honor her with love and respect without repaying us 100-fold. St. Bonaventure says that Mary will greet us with grace if we greet her with the Hail Mary. Who could possibly understand the graces and blessings which the greeting and tender regard of Our Lady affect in us? From the very first instant that Saint Elizabeth heard the greeting that the Mother of God gave her, she was filled with the Holy Spirit, and the child in her womb leaped for joy. If we make ourselves worthy of the greeting and blessings of Our Lady, we shall certainly be filled with graces, and a flood of spiritual consolations will come down into our souls. 19th Rose, Happy Exchange. It is written, "Give, and it shall be given unto you." To take Blessed Alan's illustration of this, supposing each day I give you 150 diamonds, even if you were my enemy, would you not forgive me? Would you not treat me as a friend and give me all the graces that you are able to give? If you want to gain the riches of grace and of glory, salute the Blessed Virgin. Honor your good mother. He that honoreth his mother, the Blessed Virgin, is as one that layeth up a treasure. So every day do give her at least 50 Hail Marys, for each one is worth 15 precious stones, and they please Our Lady far more than all the riches of this world put together. And you can expect such great things from her generosity. She is our mother and our friend. She is the Empress of the universe and loves us more than all the mothers and queens of the world have ever loved any one human being. This is really so, for the charity of the Blessed Virgin far surpasses the natural love of all mankind, and even of all the angels, as St. Augustine says. One day, St. Gertrude had a vision of our Lord counting gold coins. She summoned the courage to ask him what he was doing. He answered, "I am counting the Hail Marys that you have said. This is the money with which you can pay your way to heaven." The holy and learned Jesuit, Father Suarez, was so deeply aware of the value of the angelic salutation that he said that he would gladly give all his learning for the price of one Hail Mary that had been said properly. Blessed Alan de la Roche said, "Let everyone who loves you, O Most Holy Mary, listen to this and drink it in. Whenever I say, Hail Mary, the court of heaven rejoices and the earth is lost in wonderment. And I despise the world and my heart is brimful of the love of God. When I say, Hail Mary, all my fears wilt and die and my passions are quelled. If I say, Hail Mary, devotion grows within me, and sorrow for sin awakens. When I say Hail Mary, hope is made strong in my breast, and the dew of consolation falls on my soul more and more, because I say Hail Mary. And my spirit rejoices, and sorrow fades away, when I say Hail Mary." For the sweetness of this blessed salutation is so great that there are no words to explain it adequately. And even when its wonders have been sung, we still find it so full of mystery and so profound that its depths can never be plumbed. It has but few words, but is exceeding rich in mystery. It is sweeter than honey and more precious than gold. We should often meditate upon it in our hearts and have it ever upon our lips, so as to say it devoutly again and again. Blessed Alan says that a nun who had always had great devotion to the Holy Rosary appeared after death to one of her sisters in religion and said to her, "If I were allowed to go back into my body to have the chance of saying just one single Hail Mary, even if I said it quickly and without great fervor, I would gladly go through the sufferings that I had during my last illness all over again, in order to gain the merit of this prayer." This is all the more compelling because she had been bedridden and had suffered agonizing pains for several years before she died. Michel de Lucelle, Bishop of Sauber, who was a disciple and co-worker of Blessed Alan's in the reestablishment of the Holy Rosary, said that the angelic salutation is the remedy for all ills that we suffer as long as we say it devoutly in honor of Our Lady. 20th Rose, the Hail Mary, Explanation. Are you in the miserable state of sin? Then call on the Divine Mary and say to her, Ave, which means, I salute thee with the most profound respect, thou who art without sin, and she will deliver you from the evil of your sins. Are you groping in the darkness of ignorance and error? Go to Mary and say to her, Hail Mary, which means, Hail, thou who art bathed in the light of the Son of Justice, and she will give you some of her light. Have you strayed from the path leading to heaven? Then call on Mary, for her name means Star of the Sea, the North Star, which guides the ship of our souls during the voyage of this life. And she will guide you to the harbor of eternal salvation. Are you in sorrow? Turn to Mary, for her name means also Sea of Bitterness, which has been filled with sharp pain in this world, but which is now turned into a sea of the purest joy in heaven. And she will turn your sorrow to joy and your afflictions into consolation. Have you lost the state of grace? Praise and honor the numberless graces with which God has filled the Blessed Virgin and say to her, Thou art full of grace and filled with all the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and she will give you some of these graces. Are you all alone, having lost God's protection? Pray to Mary and say, The Lord is with thee. And this union is far nobler and more intimate than that which he has with saints and the just, because thou art one with him. He is thy son, and his flesh is thy flesh. Thou art united to the Lord because of thy perfect likeness to him, and by your mutual love, for thou art his mother. And then say to her, The three persons of the Godhead are with thee because thou art the temple of the most blessed Trinity. And she will place you once more under the protection and care of Almighty God. Have you become an outcast, and have you been accursed by God? Then say to Our Lady, Blessed art thou above all women and above all nations, by thy purity and fertility. Thou hast turned God's maledictions into blessings for us, and she will bless you. Do you hunger for the bread of grace and the bread of life? Draw near to her who bore the living bread which came down from heaven, and say to her, Blessed be the fruit of thy womb, whom thou hast conceived without the slightest loss of thy virginity, whom thou didst carry without discomfort, and to whom thou didst give birth without pain. Blessed be Jesus, who has redeemed our suffering world when we were in the bondage of sin, who has healed the world of its sickness, who has raised the dead to life, brought home the banished, restored sinners to a life of grace, and who has saved men from damnation. Without doubt, your soul will be filled with the bread of grace in this life and of eternal glory in the next. Amen. Then, at the end of your prayer, pray thus with Holy Mother Church. Holy Mary, holy in body and in soul, holy because of thy incomparable and eternal devotion to the service of God, holy in thy great rank of Mother of God. Who has endowed thee with eminent holiness, a worthy attribute of this great dignity? Mother of God, and our Mother, our Advocate and Mediatrix, thou who art the treasurer of God's graces, and who dost dispense them as thou seest fit, oh, we beg of thee, obtain for us soon the forgiveness of our sins, and grant that we may be reconciled with God's infinite majesty. Pray for us sinners. Thou who art always filled with compassion for those in need, thou who wilt never despise sinners or turn them away, for but for them thou wouldst never have been Mother of the Redeemer, pray for us. Now, during this short life, so fraught with sorrow and uncertainty, pray for us now. Now, because we can be sure of nothing except the present moment, pray for us now. That we are being attacked night and day by powerful and ruthless enemies, pray for us now. And at the hour of our death, so terrible and full of danger, when our strength is waning and our spirits are sinking and our souls and bodies are worn out with fear and pain. Pray for us then, at the hour of our death, when the devil is working with might and main to ensnare us and cast us into perdition. Pray for us at the turning point, when the die will be cast once and for all, and our lot forever and ever will be heaven or hell. Come to the help of thy poor children, gentle Mother of Pity, and oh, advocate and refuge of sinners, protect us at the hour of our death, and drive far from us our bitter enemies, the devils, our accusers. Those with frightful presence fill us with dread. Light our path through the valley of the shadow of death. Please, Mother, lead us to thy Son's judgment seat, and do not forsake us there. Intercede for us, and ask thy Son to forgive us, and let us into the ranks of the blessed, thy elect, in the realm of everlasting glory. Amen. So be it. No one could help admiring the beauty of the Holy Rosary, which is made up of two heavenly things, the Lord's Prayer and the Angelic Salutation. How could there possibly be any prayers more pleasing to Almighty God and the Blessed Virgin, or any that are easier, more precious, or more helpful than these two prayers? We should always have them in our hearts and on our lips to honor the most blessed Trinity, Jesus Christ our Savior and His Holy Mother. In addition, at the end of each decade, it is very good to add a Gloria Patri. That is to say, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.